Welcome to Asbury. I'm Brother Hammett, and I'm so glad that you're with us today. As you prepare to worship with us on our live stream, I invite you to make space wherever you are for worship, if you're able. You may want to silence your devices and make yourself comfortable, maybe light some candles. Please do take just a moment and let us know that you're here. You can do that in a couple of different ways. The first way is to scan the QR code on your screen. All you have to do is open the camera on your phone or smart device and aim it at the screen, and you'll receive an invitation to open our sign-in webpage. Or you can just make a comment in the chat or like the video. If you're looking for a church home, you're always welcome at Asbury. If you'd like to visit about joining the Asbury family, just email me at the address below, and I'd be glad to work out a time when we can visit. I pray that God blesses you through this service today. We'll begin in just a moment.
Good morning. How is everybody? Welcome to Asbury United Methodist Church. It's so good to see you all. Please stand and say hello to somebody around you today. Let's be the friendliest church in town. Standing as we do our call to worship.
This morning is World Communion Sunday, so in honor of that, we are going to do the call of worship in German this morning. If you understand the language, please follow along. If not, just respond in bold in English. So, you know. Wir sind alle eine Familie. Wir sind alle geschaffen in der Vorstellung Gottes.
We are all one family,
brothers and sisters. Wir sind alle eine Familie, jeder einzigartig, jeder besonders. We are all one family, brothers and sisters. Go on to the next. There we go. Wir sind alle eine Familie, geben und teilen Geschenke und Talente. We're all one family, given gifts and talents to share. We are all one family on one journey of faith. We are all one family, brothers and sisters.
I will feast at the table of the Lord. I will feast at the table of the Lord.
There's I'm invited. Nations rise and nations fall, but God is Lord above them all. Reign, Jesus, reign. The kingdoms of this world become the kingdoms of the risen Son. Reign, Jesus, reign. We're declaring that your kingdom has come. We're declaring. Your truth and light shine, Jesus, shine. As the waters fill the sea, so let your glory be. Shine, Jesus, shine. We're declaring that your kingdom has come.
Amen. Good morning. Please have a seat. Welcome to Asbury United Methodist Church. What a joy it is to be in worship with all of you today. I am so thankful you're here, whether you're here with us in the WAC or whether you're joining us online. We pray that our worship this morning is a blessing to you. It is, as Jennifer said, it is World Communion Sunday, which is a truly special day in the life of the Christian community and in the life of Asbury. We'll gather around the table a little bit later on in the service to participate in the Lord's Supper. If you're watching online, I encourage you to gather your communion elements. If you are here with us, we will do that here later on in the service, but we will join with our brothers and sisters around the globe this morning with the Lord's Supper. I do want to tell you that down here in the front, we have a basket for our community services offering. We do that every Communion Sunday, and that's an opportunity to give just a little more than what you may normally give, and we use that to funnel right back into the community to help meet the needs of our brothers and sisters. To my right and to my left are actually trash cans for your juice cups. And I encourage you not to mix the two up as you come through this morning. Checks covered in grape juice are not the best thing for us to deal with. And so, community offering, trash, and we will be all good. We are continuing our series United this morning. In fact, we're wrapping it up. Brother Hammett's going to wrap it up today, talking about what it means to be united in love. And it's a wonderful message. I've heard it already, and I pray that it's a blessing to you. I have just a few announcements to go through, and then we will work back into our worship service. The first is that we have a children's family event this afternoon, and that's going to be at Bowbrook Farms. And so it's at 3:30, and what you want to do is just meet at Bowbrook Farms. The cost for that, I think, is $7. Right? Okay, so bring $7 and your attitude of fun, and it'll be a great afternoon together for the children's ministry. Next Sunday is our children's Sabbath, and so we will have in both services, we will have our children very active and participating in our worship services. We will also have a performance from our children's choir. They've been working very hard, and they can't wait to show you what they got. And so they'll do that next Sunday. We pray that you're here for that. And then on Sunday the 23rd, October is very busy, we're going to have our Trunk or Treat and Fall Festival from 4 to 6 p.m. here at the church. And we are actually looking for help in a couple of ways. The first way that you can help is to sponsor a trunk. And so I encourage you to do that either individually or do that as a Sunday school class. And in fact, in the sanctuary, I sent a challenge to every Sunday school class because the youth are going to do three trunks, and you don't want to be outdone by a bunch of teenagers. And so make sure you come and show up. We're also taking candy donations from now until the 23rd, and you can drop those off at the office. And so if you go right out this door, Nicole has set up a sign-up area for those who wish to help with Trunk or Treat. So we need a lot of hands to make something like that go. And then the very last announcement, and this is pressing and it's breaking news. The pumpkins are arriving. Last week, I told you they're coming on Tuesday. They are now coming tomorrow. They will be here at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and we need to unload half a semi-truck full of pumpkins. And so if you are available, I encourage you to be here at the church tomorrow at 4. Show up at 5. I guarantee you we'll still be working and we'll still need the help. But it's a great way if you want to get in your squats and your curls. You can skip the gym tomorrow and just come unload pumpkins. But I want to thank you in advance for any help, and thank you for all the ways in which you support the Pumpkin Patch. And then it will open for business on Tuesday at 11 o'clock. With that, let's go to God in prayer. Gracious, loving God, I thank you so much for this beautiful morning, for this opportunity that you have given us to gather together as your children to praise and glorify your name. God, our hearts are overwhelmed this morning as we think of all of our brothers and sisters of the faith who are gathering around your table to experience your love and grace through the sacrament of Holy Communion. We pray, God, that all of your blessings are poured out upon them. We also pray this morning, God, for all of those who don't yet know you, who don't know the power of your unending love and grace. And we ask today that they are drawn near to you. We also ask, God, that you use us in any way that you need for us to help with that. Transform us this morning, God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, so that we can be a fire in the community for those who need to know the love of your Son, Jesus Christ. And it is in his name, our Lord and Savior Jesus, that we gather this morning. It is through him that all is possible for us. Through the love he showed us through his ministry, what he has taught us and is teaching us, his powerful sacrifice on the cross, the victory over sin and death at his resurrection that set us all free. And we thank you for knowing how to pray. He taught us that with the Lord's Prayer. And I will now turn it over to my dear friend Sharath, who will read the Lord's Prayer to us.
The Lord's Prayer. Parlokamandana Matandri, Ninamam Parshuddha Parchungaka. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Ni Rajyam Ochunugaka, thy kingdom come. Ni Chittam Parlokamandu Nerverchunatlu Bhumiyandu Nerverungaka. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Manudina Haram Nidumaku Daichemu. Give us this day our daily bread. My Adal Apradam Chesnavarnim Kshaminch Prakaram Apradam Kshaminchimu. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespassed against us. Mammanu Shodhanalu Taika Keedu Nunchi Tappinchumu. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Rajyamu Shaktiyu Mahimayu Nirantaram Nivai Unnavu. Amen. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please stand and continue to worship with us this morning.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing.
Sing it out, Jesus Messiah.
Jesus Messiah. Name above all. Amen.
seat.
Hi, my name is Ashley Burks, and I'm the communications director here at Asbury. And Carol Godwin and I are going to talk about the food and diaper pantry. First, I want to announce our first annual Pastor Pantry Knockout benefiting the food and diaper pantry. It starts today and goes until the 23rd. And we have Hammett Pampered Preacher Evans in this corner battling Nick Cleric of Cannes Shimmer in this corner. Okay. So what we want you to do is we want you to bring food. And I sent out a list on the things email, and I will also send that back out. Diapers and larger sizes, wipes, diaper cream, and we would love donations of money, too, so we can go out and get what we need. We're going to have a designated area in the bullpen of the office, and we'll have it split down the middle. Nick will be on one side, Hammett will be on the other, and then we will announce at the trunk or treat who wins. Winner will be announced. The loser will have to do something very embarrassing. But nobody really loses because the pantries will win. But this past Tuesday, we had our first diaper pantry drive-through. We served 36 families, including 46 children. We gave out 52 packages of wipes and 1,384 diapers. So our pantry was stocked, and now it's not so stocked. We are needing bigger sizes and pull-ups. We had parents, foster parents, pregnant moms, and grandparents coming through. So the need is huge, and we need your support. We were also looking for volunteers on Tuesdays from 11 to 1, the second and fourth Tuesday, to come out and just help replenish our supply that we have. And we appreciate your support.
Hi, I'm Carol Godwin. Most of you know we've had a food pantry here since late 2016. And in a typical month, we usually gave out like maybe 60 bags of food, plus or minus. Starting in June, our numbers started climbing when inflation hit, gas prices went up. The month of September, we gave out 171 bags of groceries. So we were wiped out afterwards. And our pantry has always depended on each of you to either bring food or donate money. We're solely sponsored by the church. So just wanted to ask you to prayerfully consider either bringing goods or maybe making an extra mile pledge. If 100 families gave $10 each for the next few months, that'd be $1,000 a month, and it would go far. So you can write a check and put food pantry on the memo line or text to 73256, and you can online text by giving, and you can note the food pantry or the diaper pantry in the memo line. So thank you.
That news is humbling, and it's a blessing all at the same time. It's humbling to hear just how much need there is in our community, but it's also a blessing to hear all the ways in which this church continues to support and love the community around it. And so I'm so thankful for you, and above all else, I'm thankful for God to put this vision of a need for a diaper pantry on some of our church members, and then we were able to answer that call, and now we see the need. Okay, and so now we know that this is a space that we need to serve in. So I pray today that we can embrace that and continue to move in that direction through our giving of our time and our resources. And with that, as we prepare for our offering, let's go to God in prayer. Gracious, loving God, we give all glory to you this morning. We know that you place a big call on our lives to be the hands and feet in this community, to see where the needs are and to not just pray about it, but to act. God, this morning, we are so blessed to be part of your community, to be your children through Jesus Christ. And God, today we just ask that you continue to work on us, that you continue to transform us through the power of the Holy Spirit. Help us see the power of our time and our talents and our resources and what they can do to make change. And God, this morning, during this time of giving, be with us as you always are. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
I kind of have to admit something. Paxton, I butchered the lyrics to this next song, so you can just keep it on the title slide. I used a different version, but it's very familiar. it would confuse more than it helped.
And I'm going to do my best to not butcher 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 13, in Spanish and English. And Nick and I joked about reading it in Greek, which is the original language, and it was just too doggone hard to do that. I can read it, but I can't speak it. So anyway, this is 1 Corinthians 13. Si yo hablara lenguas humanas y angélicas, pero no tengo amor, he llegado a ser como metal que resuena, o símbolo que retiñe. If I speak the tongues of mortals and angels, but have no love, that makes me a trumpet blast or a cymbal crash. Y si tuviera el don de profecía y entendiera todos los misterios y todo conocimiento, y si tuviera toda la fe como para trasladar montañas, pero no tengo amor, nada soy. And if I have the gift of prophecy and know all the mysteries and possess all knowledge and have faith enough to move mountains, but have no love, I'm nothing. Y si diera todos mis bienes para dar de comer a los pobres, y si entregara mi cuerpo para ser quemado, pero no tengo amor, de nada me aprovecha. And if I turn all my possessions into bread for the poor and deliver up my body for my greater glory hereafter, but have no love, it does me no good. El amor es paciente, es bondadoso. El amor no tiene envidia. El amor no es jactancioso, no es arrogante. Love can wait. Love has a heart. Love doesn't begrudge, doesn't brag, isn't inflated. No se porta indecorosamente, no busca lo suyo, no se irrita, no toma en cuenta el mal recibido, doesn't act crude, doesn't take advantage, doesn't pick fights, doesn't plot evil. No se rego quija de la injusticia, sino que se alegra con la verdad, and takes no delight in doing harm, but delights together in the truth. Todo lo sufre, todo lo cree, todo lo espera, todo lo soporta. It is always accepting, always believing, always hoping, always enduring. El amor nunca deja de ser, pero si hay dones de profecía, se acabarán. Si hay lenguas, se serán. Si hay conocimiento, se acabará. Love never fails. Prophecies, they'll be disproven. Tongues, they will be stilled. Knowledge, it will be superseded. Porque en parte conocemos, y en parte profetizamos. For we know in part and prophesy in part. Pero cuando venga lo perfecto, lo incompleto se acabará. But when perfection comes, the partial will be abolished. Cuando era niño, hablaba como niño, pensaba como niño, razonaba como niño. Pero cuando llegué a ser hombre, dejé las cosas de niño. When I was a baby, I talked like a baby, felt like a baby, thought like a baby. Now that I'm a man, I've put the baby things away. Porque ahora vemos por un espejo, veladamente, pero entonces veremos cara a cara. Ahora conozco en parte, pero entonces conoceré plenamente, como he sido conocido. You see, for now, we look as if in a mirror, shrouded in mystery, but then we will see face to face. Now I partly discern, but then I will perceive the same way that I was perceived all along. Y ahora permanecen la fe, la esperanza y el amor, estos tres. Pero el mayor de ellos es el amor. And so we have faith, hope, and love, these three, but the greatest of these is love. La palabra de Dios para el pobre de Dios. Gracias a Dios. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, good morning and welcome to Asbury. I'm so glad you're here with us in the room, and thanks to those of you who are worshiping with us online. In the earlier service, we actually had, you know, it's World Communion Sunday. This is kind of cool. One of my friends from England was worshiping with us in the service at 9 via YouTube. And so our online worship has a way of bringing people together from all over the place. We always have views, of course, in Arkansas, you know, Central Arkansas, exotic places like Mena, Arkansas, and places like that. But we also have, every week, we have folks from all over the country and occasionally from across the world. And we're so glad that you are worshiping with us, either live or later on at your convenience. And before we move into the sermon, I just want to say I'm so grateful for Carol and for Ashley and for their ministry, their work that they're doing to serve our neighbors. Michelle and I talked about it a couple of weeks ago when Carol came to me first, and we decided to make a second mile pledge of $100 a month. This is over and above our regular giving to Asbury's budget. And I want to invite you to consider doing something like that, to pitch in. The budget always runs behind ministry. Amen? The budget usually runs behind ministry. And so we have felt called to this ministry, and we've jumped into it, and we've trusted that the Lord will provide. Amen? And so we may work that into next year's budget, but for right now, I really want to encourage you to do what you can. You might not be able to do $100 a month. Maybe it's 10, maybe it's 5, but whatever you can do, I know that God will bless it and use it to meet more than the need that we have in our area. So today, we're wrapping up our United series, and over the last few weeks, we've been talking about what it means to be united as Methodists in a world that is broken and in a denomination that is crumbling. Today we're going to see that we are united by love above all. Let us pray. God, who brings us together, we pray now that you will pour out your Holy Spirit upon us so that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, you who are our strength and our friend, our rock, and our Redeemer. And the people of God said, amen. You don't have to raise your hand, but have you ever had a family feast that turned into a full-on feud? maybe around Thanksgiving or something like that, when that crazy uncle showed up. You know, I don't know why, but somehow a meal can bring us together, but it can also be a source of division. It's a place where all of the underlying frustration and pent-up anger and all of that can rip off the scabs of all of our unhealed wounds. And it's the same in churches. It was certainly that way in ancient Corinth. Over the last few weeks, we've seen how divided the Corinthian church was as a church family. They were fighting over everything that could be fought about. Which was the best preacher they ever had? Which of them was the smartest? Which one was the wisest? Which one had the greatest spiritual gifts? They were fighting over what to eat and drink and what not to eat and what not to drink, what to wear in church, what not to wear in church. They were even divided about all of these things when they came together at the Lord's Supper. Back then, and I kind of wish this was the case today, but every time Christians got together to worship, they shared a meal together. And then it was kind of a pre-meal before communion. You can consider it kind of a pre-Eucharist tailgate party, I suppose. But the people who could afford to get off work early, because they didn't have the kind of work week we have, but the people who could afford to get off work early or not work at all would show up early. And they would be dressed in their fine linen togas and with all their jewelry, and they would bring the finest gourmet cuisine, and they would drink their fancy Greek wine. But later on, when the poor working class folks arrived, after they got off work, the rich folks had already eaten up all the communion bread, and they were passed out drunk on the communion wine. Now, if you don't think that actually happened, that is what Paul says in chapter 11 of 1 Corinthians, verse 21. And so word gets back to Paul that this kind of stuff is going on. These class distinctions that are out in the world were coming into the Lord's table itself, and Paul was stunned. He admonishes them in chapter 11 not to eat the Lord's Supper in such an unworthy, selfish manner. The Lord's Supper, the Lord's table, is a place of unity, not division. Well, then in chapter 12, he moves he tells them again that the church is the body of Christ. We are united for a purpose. Each person has a gift to be shared. Each person, no matter how insignificant by the world's standards, is a vital part of Christ's body. And then in chapter 13, Paul cuts directly to the heart of the matter. He says, followers of Jesus have been loved unconditionally so that they can love unconditionally. We are loved to love. Christ loved others unconditionally. We see that on the cross. And so therefore, we love one another unconditionally within the church and beyond the church. Paul says that living your life to share the unconditional love of Jesus Christ with everyone indiscriminately is the best way to live. In fact, we just read a moment ago that he is bold enough to say you can have everything. You can have all the material possessions. You can be the richest person in the world. You can have every other spiritual gift. But if you do not have unconditional love in your heart, Paul says you're nothing. Methodists historically have taken that to heart. A long time ago, people would ask the founder of Methodism, John Wesley, what it meant to be a Methodist. Back then, it was kind of an add-on to going to the Church of England. And why would you want to go to chapel in the afternoon after you've already been to church and received the sacrament in the morning? And so John Wesley said that this is what being a Methodist is all about. He said, a Methodist is one who has the love of God shed abroad in their heart by the Holy Ghost. A Methodist is somebody who loves the Lord their God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength, and their neighbor as themselves. Wesley imagines somebody saying, well, John, isn't that just a plain old ordinary Christian? And John's answer is, that's right. A Methodist is just a plain old vanilla Christian. When the United Methodist Church was formed on April 23rd, 1968, in my own birthplace, Dallas, Texas, Didn't last there long. It wasn't there long, really, from families from Arkansas and all that. But when we were formed in April of 1968, the United Methodist Church was created to be a vehicle for the unconditional love of Jesus Christ in the world. That is what we were created to be. We were created to live a kind of radical, Christ-centered love. And I'm going to share with you just a little bit of the sermon that Reverend Dr. Albert Outler preached at the opening ceremonies at the Uniting Conference of our denomination. Here's part of what he said today. He said, the United Methodist Church, the church we are called to be, must be a church ablaze with a passion that God's gospel shall be preached and heard and responded to in faith and hope and love by all who can be reached and instructed and gathered into the fellowship of God's covenanted people. The fullness of the gospel embraces all human concerns everywhere and always, but the heart of the gospel is startlingly simple, that God loves you and me and all people with a very special love, and that Jesus Christ is the sufficient proof of this love to everyone who will receive and confess him as Savior and Lord. The gospel is the good news that it is God's love that pardons, heals, and reconciles. God's love that demands that we be fully human and opens up this possibility for us. God's love that can sanctify our memories and our hopes. And yet, this same gospel Outler preached also reminds us in every human circumstance that our salvation comes from God's sheer unmerited favor. In no sense can it ever be earned or bought or wheedled. It does not come by any merit or demerit, by any good works or bad, by any claim that we can bring on our own behalf. That's the unconditional love in which the United Methodist Church was founded. And that kind of unconditional love unites us across any wall that would divide us. Outler mentions the distinctions of race, class, sex, culture. We could add politics and differences of opinion on matters that do not strike at the root of Christianity. At the end of that sermon, Outler said, United Methodists are united to be uniting. We unite traditionalists and progressives and centrists or moderates. We bring all of those folks together as we seek to love one another and the whole world with the unconditional love of Jesus Christ. Now, you don't have to tell me it's hard to see that right now in the current state of our denomination, but that is the heart of who we are as United Methodists, and it will be for the future. Now, I saw that kind of love so clearly several years ago when Michelle and I went on a mission trip to Costa Rica. I know some of y'all have been on OMP and other mission trips, and you could literally feel the presence of the Holy Spirit walking and working with us. In the picture, you see Michelle in her Arkansas Monticello shirt, and that's me with a hat on. And then Pastor Victor Vargas was their pastor of the United Methodist Church there in Alajuela. So the Costa Ricans, or the Ticos, as they call themselves, were very different from us. We were divided in so many ways. We were divided by our language. We were divided by our cultures. They had so much less. Even the most wealthy one of them had so much less than the poorest one of us. Their church building had no chairs, no pews, no altar, no hymnals, no screen, no stained glass windows. In fact, they had no windows at all. That is in an open worship space. But we got to know these new brothers and sisters of ours, and the night before we returned home, we invited them to come and join us where we were staying at the Methodist Center, to join us for Holy Communion. And their pastor told me it was the very first time that any American group had invited them to come and worship with them. So together, first I preached in really bad Spanish and then a short sermon in English as well. And then together, Victor and I prayed the communion prayers in Spanish and in English. I took the bread and broke it, and I shared it and the cup with him. This is the body of Christ broken for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. And then he shared the bread and the cup with me. Estos son símbolos del cuerpo y la sangre de Jesucristo para ti. So I invited everybody to stand up and stand in a circle to receive communion. And Victor took the bread and I took the cup. And we went to the first person, and that person was from our group. They were an American. So we get there, and Victor looks at me, and he stops me. And he says, ¿Cómo se dice en inglés? How do you say it in English? And he spoke very little English, much less English than I spoke Spanish. And so I spoke very slowly, and I said, this is the body of Christ broken for you. And then Victor and I went around the circle from person to person, serving the body and blood of Christ in each other's language. And as we did, I swear I could hear the Spirit say, this is my family. I lived for them. I love them so much that I died for them. I made this sacrifice to unite them as my family. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and the people of God said, amen. Let us pray. God, we do thank you for creating us as your beloved family. Each and every one of us is your beloved child. And we pray for our world in the midst of violence and war and turmoil. We pray for the United Methodist Church and for the ways that we have divided ourselves up into opposing camps. And God, we pray that you will give us a spirit of your peace, that we might truly be a church that is united to unite, that seeks to share your unconditional love both within and without the walls of Asbury. We pray this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, and the people of God said, amen. As we transition into our sacrament of Holy Communion, I want you to know if you're a guest today, you don't have to be a member of our church. You don't have to be a member of any church to receive the sacrament here. In the United Methodist Church, we believe that this is the Lord's table. It's not our table, and all of God's children are welcome to come and freely receive. I think Nick mentioned earlier, we do have some of the self-contained packs back at the back. Looks like Preston's holding those up. And if you would prefer to use one of those rather than come forward, you're welcome. You're welcome to go to him, and he'll be glad to give you one. If you're joining us, if you're worshiping with us online, it's time now to go ahead and get your bread and grape juice or wine, if that's what you have on hand, to receive in just a few moments. The offering plate or the basket at the front is also for our community ministries fund that helps needy people in our community. Would you please join me as printed on the screen? The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to evil, sin, and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, shared it with his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so as we remember these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith together, saying, "Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again." Pour out your Holy Spirit on us wherever we are gathered and on our gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood.
Gracious and loving God, we lift up all who are ill or in special need of your grace. We pray especially for Clifford Smith and Virgin Glazier. We pray for Fred Williams and for Barbara Clark. Pray for Megan Arnold and Joyce Dennis. Pray for Gene Hammett and Mark Schimmer. Pray for Val Carr and for David Hickman. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, now and forever, Almighty Father. Amen.
Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ.
The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ.
As our servers are coming forward, I'd like to invite those who are online or who are distanced to receive your elements at this time. Also, we do have gluten-free wafers if you need that. You can just ask one of your servers or one of the ushers for that when you come forward.
Life with him, nor will you be raised.
Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And right now I'd like to take a moment. I'd like to invite Elaine and David Hickman to come join us. And we're going to come to you as well. I'd like to introduce Elaine and David Hickman to everybody. If you were here last week, Elaine joined the church, became a member of Asbury. Her husband, David, has joined us this week to join the church as well. They are transferring their membership from another United Methodist church. And so I have asked Scott Corley to be here with me. He's one of our lay leader representatives. And so what we usually do is there's a congregational response at the end of the membership vows, and we don't have time to put that on the screen. So Scott is going to give that response on all of your behalf. And if you disagree with any of it, you can take it up with Scott. David, I'm going to ask you two very simple questions. First, as a member of Christ's Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If so, say, I will.
I will.
And as a member of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service? And members of the household of God, I commend David and Elaine to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love.
We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ.
The God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Elaine and David, welcome to the family. We're thankful to have you. And I am sure that Dave and Elaine will hang out for a moment at the end of the service so everybody has a chance to come by and meet both of them. And with that,
Cue the music. All right, got it.
Please stand and join us for our last song this morning.
How could it be that my God would welcome me into this mystery? Say, take this bread, take this wine, now the simple made divine for any to receive.
By your mercy.
By your mercy we come. By your grace, you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember you.
thank you so much for being here today. Next Sunday, you know, we're finished with this series, and next few weeks we're going to be doing kind of one-off things. And next Sunday, I'm so excited. It's Children's Sabbath. Kids are going to be singing, participating in worship, and the sermon next Sunday will be on the book of Jonah. So it'll be you can't say a whale of a tail because it's a fish, not a whale. But anyway, that's another story. But anyway, we'll do that next week. Thank you so much for being here today, and would you please receive this blessing? Go forth with Christ above you to be your guide, with Christ below you to hold you up, with Christ beside you to be your friend, and with Christ within you to give you hope, love, joy, and peace. Go forth with Jesus Christ, your Lord. And the people of God said, amen.